Hello, and welcome to Character Class. Today I'd like to talk to you about five types of characters that you need to stop making right now. Okay? That's a bit of a loaded beginning, but hear me out. Because we're going to be delving into five character types, five archetypes that can cause problems. I may have touched on this a bit in some other ones, and I'll say it now, and I'll probably say it again at the end. Despite the fact that I'm saying you need to stop making these types of characters, I'm not saying that they can't work. I'm not saying that there aren't places for these types of characters. But what I'm saying is that the odds of these characters working tend to be more skewed against you than for you. So, hear me out. All right. Number one, in no particular order. Well, let's start at the bottom. Number five is, of course, the Wesley Snipes character. What I mean by that is basically like the Master Slayer, like Blade. The absolute badass type combat monster that can go in and take care of any problem. Usually doesn't tend to have a lot of backstory, usually doesn't tend to have a lot of social interaction. They tend to be extremely focused on one thing and one thing only. And that sort of thing, while it can have its place in some games, tends to fall apart whenever you don't have combat in your game, because there's nothing for that character to do. And that's where the problem comes in. Because if you have a character that is so focused in combat and you start throwing social situations and political situations at them, that character isn't very good at those sorts of things and will tend to fail. And the player of that character may get upset because they don't want to play those types of things. So it all comes down to being there in the character creation. That is where things need to be dealt with. Because like pretty much every aspect of these characters, talking with your ST, talking with your other players and the party members and whatnot, and figuring out how everything will mesh together and how they will work. That is key to any gaming group, any party of characters. So you need to talk with your ST about pretty much any of these types of archetypes, but specifically the Wesley Snipes, the Blade, the Master Slayer that you have out there. It's the sort that can work, but probably not, depending on the type of situation you find yourself in. But that is, again, all dependent on campaign and story and whatnot that's going on. The next one, number four is the Lone Wolf. Now, the Lone Wolf character is the one that is, of course, typically denoted by the loner archetype or the lone wolf archetype that's out there. It is the character that is always off doing his own thing, doesn't want to be involved with anything going on, any stories or whatnot, tend to always give the brush off to the party and are always off doing their own thing. And this sort of character doesn't really work, because it's not only pulling the storyteller's attention in two different directions, because not only do you have to keep an eye on the rest of the party, but you also have to have content for what your lone wolf character is doing off by himself, which it also ends up tending to be boring for the lone wolf character, because their stuff, if the storyteller does have stuff set up for them, tends to get resolved quickly because it's just dealing with one player. Whereas the rest of the group, there's multiple players, things tend to take longer to resolve, the lone wolf character is then left twiddling their thumbs. So when you're making a lone wolf character, these types of characters can work, but it is much easier to have a character that wants to be interactive with other players and characters and wants to help the party as a whole, wants to get involved in things. It's much easier to work in a character like that than it is to work in a character that wants nothing to do with any of these types. You see where the problem lies. Now again, I'm not saying the lone wolf character can't work. There's always situations where it can. Pretty specific situations, but there are some. And again, that's the sort of thing you want to talk to your storyteller about ahead of time to see if they can fit you in. Number three. Number three is the extra most bestest character. This type of character is typified by the Mary Sues or the Mary Stews. Or we've also got the Edgelords. Mr. Darkness McEdgelord. Basically, the extra most bestest character is the type of character that is the ones that are good at everything. Their stuff is spread out. Their backstory is written in this deeply, overly dramatic way where the plot of the campaign itself tends to revolve around them if they can manage it. They try to make the plot revolve around them. They try to have themselves connected to everything and be a part of everything all at once. They are the extra most bestest character out there, the super special snowflake. And this type of character, as I said, tends to be typified by the Mary Sues, but also by the Edgelords, because the Edgelords are the ones that are very much kind of rooted in the 90s grim, dark, gritty aesthetic, where there's always super tragic backstory going on, but they are super well-trained. They are good at everything. It's basically like Batman. It's like Batman. You're playing Batman when you're playing the Edgelord. You have tricks for everything out there. And these characters, while on the surface they might seem good, to have a character that's good at everything and can do everything and solve all the problems, that's great. It's also not. Because then if you've got one character doing all the heavy lifting, you're leaving nothing for your other players to do, your other characters. And that can lead to some resentment among players. The ones that tend to play the extra most bestest characters, it's so fun to say that, also tend to be the one that like to hog the spotlight, which I talked about among problem players in another video. Again, these types of characters, they can work, especially if you are, as a storyteller, are crafting a plot that everything will be revolving around the player characters. Then yeah, you can work this in. It is possible. The odds are not in your favor, but it is possible. Number two is the stereotype. Now, I don't mean that as in, you know, a stereotypical black person character, a stereotypical Mexican character, Asian character, or any other specific race. I'm not saying that sort of stereotype. Although that sort of stereotype may be and can be in this type of character. What I'm more looking at is stereotypical character types. In terms of like the World of Darkness, like a stereotypical Fianna werewolf is basically like, oh, I'm going to play a Fianna, so I'm going to be Mr. Irish McDrinks-a-Lot. See, the stereotype. I'm going to play a Malkavian, so I'm going to be a fluffy, crazy Malkavian that does weird things because random. Or a stereotypical we'll say a stereotypical Euthanatos, so I'm going to wear a dark trench coat and kill people a lot. These sorts of things, these sorts of stereotypes are what I am talking about with the stereotype character. These ones, more than any of the other ones, they can work. You can get them in, but usually only if you're willing to take that stereotype, break it apart and deconstruct it, and rebuild the character from those pieces, throwing away what doesn't work. Which is something I like to do. But they can work. But usually these characters tend to fall into these extremely narrow niches because people are too focused on the stereotype itself and not on making the character. One thing I mentioned in one of my previous videos is when creating a character, I believe it was my tips for role playing video, where you're going to create a character. Think of that character as a person first, as a character, before you think about what that character is, be it a vampire, a werewolf, mage, or anything. And the stereotype doesn't just apply to World of Darkness. It also applies to D&D. When you're going into, for example, the stereotypical barbarian character, well, they're going to be a big hulking fighter man. Big hulking fighter mans with big muscles and low intelligence. Why? Why does a barbarian need to have low intelligence? Stereotypical elf or dwarf or anything like that. Any of these character classes and races have stereotypes to them. And you can fall into that niche of that stereotype, or you can choose to accept the abilities and the talents and the skills inherent to a class or to a race, and then build off of that, make a fully fleshed out character, without falling into that stereotype trap. And number one, we're going to do our last one. Number one character that you need to stop making now is the popular movie slash television series slash book slash etc. character. The popular movie character, as a short, is the one where you will see something, you'll see a character in a movie or on TV or read it in a book. Like Harry Dresden, for example. You read the Harry Dresden books and you're like, Harry Dresden's an awesome character. I want to make that character. Or you'll go and see Thor Ragnarok, which I just saw not that long ago, and be like, I want to make Thor, or I want to make Loki. And you'll set out to create a character that is a carbon copy of that character in the game you are playing. And maybe it will work. If you wanted to make Harry Dresden, for example, in Mage of the Ascension, that's a fairly easy swap to do. You can do that. It's not hard. The two worlds are fairly compatible because they both take place in modern day. They both deal with magic, and Mage already has its own system set up. So it's not hard to do for that. A little harder if you wanted to be like, I'm going to make Thor in Mage of the Ascension, or I'm going to make Thor in Dungeons and Dragons. Possibly not as easy. And trying to force something into a system that isn't going to work is just going to cause problems for you and problems for your storyteller or your dungeon master, who has to basically tell you, no, you can't do that. Or if they let you make that character, then they have to keep telling you, no, you can't do that. And you get upset because you're like, well, you let me play this character. That's where the problem comes in, because you have expectations of your character based off of this popular movie or this popular television series or whatever that you've taken them from. And the character you made isn't that character. As much as you tried to make it like that character, it's not that character. So there's going to be differences. And that's why it's always a problem building a character based off of something like that. I'm not saying it can't work. You can borrow stuff from certain characters online or in movies and television. You can borrow stuff. You can pay an homage to a character. Even me. And I like to consider myself, when I'm building characters, I like to consider that I'm pretty good at it. I'm pretty good at making fully fleshed out characters. I'm good at taking a concept and building it out into a plausible character. I've done quite a few homage characters as well, based off of popular movies. I'm not immune to it. And even me, that's good at it, I've done a few characters that my friends just shake their head at me at. So even I'm guilty of it. Because you get yourself all excited and wrapped up in the character that you like, and you try to play that character. So it's always better to build your own character, because then you don't fall into that trap of being like trying to pull from this television show and make it work in the game system, when sometimes the game system isn't going to handle what you want it to. It's basically a lot easier to work with an original character than it is to work with something that somebody else has already made. There are, for those of you that are interested, if you have the Vampire Player's Guide, or the Werewolf Player's Guide, as a matter of fact, or possibly even the Mage Player's Guide, a lot of the player's guides have essays written in the back talking about various things. And the Vampire Player's Guide in particular talks about certain character types, talks about stuff being taken from TV, and all kinds of stuff. Great role-playing tips and great just character creation tips and other tips and whatnot are in these player's guides. Check them out. So that's going to be it for this episode of Character Class. Thank you all so much for watching. As always, if you like what I'm doing, please give that like button a tap. Give that subscribe button a tap as well if you haven't already, so you can be kept apprised of when I do new videos. And throw a comment in the comment section. Let me know what your character types are that people need to stop making. Please, let me know in the comments below. And until next time, you all take care, and I'll see you around.